Founders MCC Los Angeles. I want to welcome any first-time visitors. If you are a first-time visitor, it's a good thing. Would you just raise your hand? We'd just like to welcome you in special ways. We just love to give you a symbol of our appreciation and your first time experience, kind of smelling the roses while you are here. What a wonderful experience. So I'm grateful. And hey, online visitors, welcome, welcome. From all over the planet, we just welcome you for tuning in. And even if you're locally, perhaps just across the street, it's okay too. We want to welcome you to our worship service and just acknowledge your presence and your prayers with us in this service. Hey, and all of you who just show up all the time, like sometimes me, I just want to welcome our regulars and our persons who have returned, who again had a vacation, and again, I didn't go with you, but that's okay. I feel you. I read about you on Facebook. I'm glad that you're here. And so welcome to worship for this installation service of a very special time in the life of our church. And so I want to give a couple of shout-outs. Because I want to work first in honor and welcome our founder, the Reverend Troy Perry, who's president in the house. And I'm going to do it the old-fashioned way, the way we used to do it. I want to welcome, because I know there are some MCC churches in the house, and I want to acknowledge MCC Las Vegas, which has been in the house. Just welcome you. I know that there are members from MCC of the Coachella Valley. Welcome. I know you're in the house. I know MCC San Diego is in the house, so welcome you. I know MCC UCC in the Valley is in the house. Welcome you. I want to welcome Resurrection Beach MCC. You're in the house. Welcome you. Are there any MCCs who are in the house that I not recognize? There you go, in Soccer Dallas. I love it. And I know there are other than the house. I see my brother friend from the UUA is in the house, and I'll get to that, and others you'll be included. And there are so many other special people. So forgive me if I've missed you. The good news is God knows where you are. I also want to acknowledge our guest preacher, and you'll hear more about him, the Reverend Wayne Lindsay. I want to acknowledge and welcome you, and I'll say more. And I want to welcome our guest vocalist, obviously Luis Ramirez, who just acknowledged from Stockton. And I want to welcome Tony Arias, and I'll do it better later, from Las Vegas in the house. So, in the good spirit of all that is, and there's more, I just know, just open up, sit back, just experience, just do something different. And in that spirit, I invite you to rise in body or spirit as you're able and extend the peace of Christ, a handshake or hug to someone new.
Realize that perhaps the realm of God has come down and is with us. It could be because angels are among us.
Estamos muy unidos, tal vez es un ángel llegando, aunque no. Amen. This morning's reading is taken from Matthew, the 13th chapter, the first through the ninth verses. This is the New International Version. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it, while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, "A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because of the soil was shallow, but when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked all the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear." Hear what the Spirit says today.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Will you welcome home Luis Ramirez as he comes to give his gift and song?
You can love on me or hate on me or wherever you are, but I'm so glad when I heard he was coming, you voted me, and I was so glad. My past partner, Jack, loved Pastor Keith. That was his pastor, so I know he was up in heaven rejoicing when the choice was made. So in a sense, we kind of dedicate the service to God. We do dedicate the service to God, but we're also dedicating Pastor Keith once again. But it's just not him who's entering into this contract. It's you as a church also. You're behind him. You support him. He can't do all the work. He can't touch everyone that you all can touch. So with him as your leader, this song is appropriate for you, Pastor Keith, and it's appropriate for you. Let them see. Just let them see you in me. Let them see you in me. I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice and it told thy love. Great is our God. Sing it with me. Sing with me. How great is our God. And all will see how great. How great is our God. Would you stand? Lift your hands. Sing it with me.
Grande, grande es Dios.
You see how God moves, the Spirit moves, and you just get out of the way. And you just let the songs flow and you open yourself. And you just lift up your hands and just be available. What a wonderful witness and a wonderful experience to have just before our message. It is true that our guest preacher is no stranger but to MCC, but he is a very close padre to Reverend Mozingo. And so it's only fitting that we give him a brief, proper introduction. I'll give the abbreviated version because we don't have that much time, only kidding. But I want to honor the fact at this installation why he was selected as the preacher to set the tone for Reverend Mozingo's installation where he says yes again. You know, they joined St. John's MCC when he did back in 1889, and he was under the ministry at that time of Reverend Lindsay. Huh? 1989. Oh. A little dyslexia comes in, little moments. All of you went to check out. Where was I in 1890? Some of you were here, but I'm not going to bring it up. And at the time when they were at St. John's MCC in Raleigh, North Carolina, Reverend Keith served as the music director for 5 years. And Wayne served as his supervising pastor when he started the clergy process. And they have just been his mentor and his padre, as he calls it, and friend for 37 years. Yeah. But Reverend Lindsay himself has served and pastored in many places. As many of you know, he's the former senior pastor of MCC of Las Vegas. And since that time, he's just been traveling the world, hanging out, being a presence. And on some Sundays, he's a member of MCC of Coachella Valley and just hanging out. So he continues to be present and offer his gifts, and I am so honored. Will you welcome the Reverend Wayne Lindsay?
Well, I think I'm holding up fairly well to be that old. Go back that far, find out things you didn't even know. We do go back quite a ways, and it is a joy to be here with you this day and to celebrate this joyous occasion. Keith and I, not only did we both were a part of St. John's MCC, but we both grew up in North Carolina, and you can probably hear it in the sound of my voice and in the sound of his voice and in the cadence of our speech. And we actually, not only did we both grow up in North Carolina, but we were also both from Eastern North Carolina, from rural agricultural communities. We are both firmly rooted in the rich, fertile soil of the coastal plain of Eastern North Carolina, which, by the way, is where you will find the best pork barbecue in the world, which is not made with tomato sauce. It's made with vinegar the way God intended it to be. You know?
That's right.
We also both grew up in church, and every Sunday we were that kind of family. But the outward expression of our faith was very different. He was a Pentecostal, and I was a Methodist. And actually, I was thinking about it as I was sitting down there. The very fact that I kind of like to stand here, you know, behind a pulpit and preach from notes, and he likes to stand down there and walk around reflects some of that difference in where we come from and our heritage. And we also both bear in our souls the seeds of our ancestors that were handed down to us, the seeds of faith. And in spite of that close proximity where we both grew up in Eastern North Carolina, it was the seeds that were planted in this place, almost 3,000 miles away and almost 50 years ago, that were what brought us together, caused us our paths to cross, and enabled our relationship to take root and to blossom and to grow and into the friendship that we have today. This past winter, I went to visit Keith for what turned out to be my last trip to his home in Baton Rouge. And while I was standing in his backyard, I noticed that the ground was covered with seeds, which I have in a little envelope here, that I just decided for no particular reason at the time to pick up. You know, something said, pick up some of these seeds. And, you know, he and I both kind of pay attention to these little voices that happen every now and then. We don't know what we're going to do with it later. But so I gathered them up and put them in my pocket. And at that time, Keith was still in the midst of prayer and discernment about what he was going to do, what was the next phase of his journey. And it would still be several months later before you would issue your historic unanimous call to have him come and be your senior pastor. So when this summer, when Keith asked me to preach at his installation, I remembered these seeds, and I thought, well, okay, maybe I could do something with these. And so I got them back out. And it occurred to me that seeds are a great symbol of inheritance and of the lineage that comes down through us, through our DNA, and also of all the experience that we carry with us from our past. And Keith brings to you a rich experience, the richness of his loving family that raised him in the church, and the richness of the various churches that he has served in the past, from St. John's in North Carolina to Tennessee to Louisiana, even his previous experience being right here in this place. The potential of all of that is embodied in this man that we come here today to install as your pastor. But you know, I also, as I thought about this day, it's not all about him, despite what he may think. Each of you brings with you the seeds from your various and diverse backgrounds that contribute to the abundance of resources that are in this place that are needed for it to continue to grow and flourish. And yes, we come here today to officially proclaim the beginning of his ministry, but I want to be emphatic about the fact that it is not his job to do all of the ministry. It is his job to facilitate and empower you to do ministry. It is his job to facilitate the gifts of God that are already embedded, the seeds that are already within you, that so that this church can move forward from where it has been into an exciting future that God is preparing for you for the next 50 years. You are the seeds of the future. Thousands of lives will be touched by you, people you don't even know yet, people who haven't even been through these doors yet, will be touched by you, and that people that don't even know that there is good news, and that that good news includes them. In Matthew's gospel that Lucia read for us today, Jesus tells a parable about someone who goes out to sow some seeds. And some of those seeds fall on very hard-packed earth where they get either trampled or are eaten by birds. Some of them fall on rocky ground where they just can't penetrate and take root. Some of them fall among the thorns and weeds and just get choked out. And fortunately, some of those seeds fall onto good ground, ground that was fertile, ground that was receptive, perhaps maybe even tilled and plowed by someone and prepared in a manner that it made it possible for it to flourish and to grow and for those seedlings to put down roots. I give thanks that Troy is here with us today and for the fact that God sowed seeds in his heart. And that he was faithful to listen to that voice, even when Willie Smith and a number of other people told him he was crazy. And he followed that voice and planted those seeds. Troy was faithful, and he found good ground, holy ground, in the founding of this church that brought forth a harvest that exceeded what was sown. The lives of people around the world have been transformed by the seeds that were planted in this place. The seeds that have gone out from here. In fact, and he may not remember this, but the very first time I ever met him was not in this church, not in this country. It was in England, where he had come with his mother, Edith, to dedicate the sanctuary of MCC London in Ballon. I remember shaking his hand. He said, "Why, your pastor is Willie White. Would you meet my mother?" And he introduced me to Edith right then and there. This church continues to have a global impact through the people that have gone out from here, through the churches that have been planted from here, through the denomination that was founded here, and also from your current internet presence. There are people with us in worship right now all around the world. We are in the midst of a great communion of saints. It's just, you know, the sense of the fullness of this room that it cannot contain is just amazing. We are flung out around the world. And you folks who are out there worshiping with us online are a vital part of what happens here, no matter where you are on this planet. Jesus often taught in parables. And parables are a peculiar literary form and type of storytelling that is often misunderstood in our modern world because people don't particularly usually talk in parables that much anymore. Parables were never intended to be stories that were allegories or stories where you could just say this means this and that means that and kind of line up everything and it all tied up with a nice little bow and it was all pretty. The reality is parables were intended to raise more questions than they were to answer. A parable is supposed to make you think instead of giving you all of the easy answers. A parable is intended to disturb our complacency. It's intended to push you out of your comfort zone sometimes. It encourages you to dislodge you from the easy path and to challenge you to move out of your stuckness, whatever that is. To move out of the ruts that you've gotten yourself mired in, and to move out of the entrenched notions of what is and what isn't possible. Parables are about potential. And potential is one of those odd things. It's a double-edged sword. Anything that really has potential has the power that you just don't know what's going to happen. The outcome is uncertain. It may be what you wanted, and it may be something you totally didn't intend. That uncertainty sometimes can paralyze us with fear and just keep us from doing anything at all. Our scripture today says, at the end of it, it says, some of the seed landed on good soil and yielded a crop 30, 60, even 100 times what was sown. Those last words, "what was sown," just kind of kept sticking in my head and in my mind. And I thought, what if that were a question? What was sown? And since parables kind of invoke questions anyway, I got to thinking about that. We don't really know. It's very open-ended, and the scripture doesn't even tell us what kind of seeds were sown. You know, if you intend to plant corn and or grow corn and you plant wheat, you're going to be a little disappointed. Or if I give you these seeds and tell you they're marijuana seeds and you plant them, not that I would know, of course, but you're probably going to be a little disappointed because it's going to be a tree from Keith's backyard in Baton Rouge. So. And if you go to a seed dealer and just say, well, give me some seeds, you're going to run the risk of getting the wrong seeds or seeds that are no longer viable. What was sown makes a difference in what is harvested. And each of us has a part to play. What you sow makes a difference. Yeah. What you sow makes a difference in the life of this church. What you sow makes a difference in the life of all of our MCC churches. And what is sown makes a difference in the life of our denomination. So what kind of seeds will you sow? Will you plant good news, or will you sow discord and strife? Will you work constructively for equality, or will you actively work against those folks who are seeking to do the challenging task of creating change? As I was thinking about that, I thought, I want us to specifically pray today for our denominational interim moderator, the Reverend Elder Rochelle Brown, who has had the courage and to confront and to challenge and to change existing structures and systems to help move us from what has been, which has been good, to an even brighter and newer future that can include even more people. Yes. So I want us to also remember that the work of an interim pastor, the calling of an interim pastor or an interim moderator, is not for the faint of heart. It is hard work because people don't like it when you start messing around with things and changing things. So your prayers and your support are important during this tender time of transition. What kind of seeds will you sow? Will you work to confront bigotry and hatred, or will you just let it slide? Will you work for justice for the poor, or will you side with those who already have more than they need? Each of us is called to build up the body of Christ. We are called to sow good seed. We're called to work to help secure that those seed do indeed fall into good ground. And I was thinking about that whole good ground thing. You know, since Keith and I come from agricultural things, we know a lot about this, even though neither one of us grew up in farming families. But even good soil can be, as we say down east, farmed out or depleted. If you just constantly plant the same crop and do the same thing year after year after year and don't rotate your crops, don't put anything back into the soil, then after a while, it won't grow anything. Good soil and good growing conditions require a proper balance of water and drainage and nutrients, and you have to have the right combination of sunlight and all of that stuff. This church has changed the ground under its feet and physically moved more times than I can even possibly recount. You know, started in Huntington Park, went to downtown Los Angeles, and then into Culver City and to West Hollywood, and I don't even know all of the places. And if you want to find out, there is a bus tour you can sign up for the part of the 50th anniversary, and they'll take you all around and you can see all of that. And they'll plug for that. This church continues to find and continues to create good ground, holy ground, in which to take root and grow. And despite, it does it in spite of discrimination, of being thrown out of buildings, in spite of arson, of having buildings burned down, in spite of earthquakes. I mean, you just endure. Staying on holy ground is not a static process where you just arrive and you just sit back on your laurels and think, well, we're here, you know, we've done it. It calls us to be vigilant. It calls us to grow. And don't think for a minute that this is necessarily the last place and the last building where you are going to be. Some folks have the gift of sowing and planting, while other folks are needed to till and tend the soil to ensure that it does indeed continue to be a fertile and welcoming place that sustains and nurtures the blessings that come from God. And sometimes the tasks before us seem almost overwhelming. But Scripture calls us to remember that when our faith is even as small as a mustard seed, smaller than these seeds, that we can still do and accomplish great things. These are exciting times in the life of this church. These are exciting times and challenging times in the life of our denomination. We are called to persist. We are called to persevere, all of us, each and every one of you are needed to move forward together as we sow and till good earth to harvest and to create a place where thousands more will come to know and follow in our footsteps for the next 50 years. The body of Christ needs all of our talents, seeds large and small. All right. Many of you are already involved here. I've been just impressed and looking around and all of the activity and things that have been going on and all of the things people have done just for this week to make this weekend possible. And then I know you've got another whole, you know, the 50th anniversary is coming up. There's another whole group of people working on that. So there's lots of people who are doing all kinds of wonderful things already. And then, of course, you've got folks like Tony and Lewis and myself who've come from out of town to add into this mix of all the abundance of talents that exist in this place. But I want to ask you today, what will you sow? What will you add? Do you have gifts of hospitality? Do you like to cook? Entertain, those are needed to make a welcoming place. Right. People who welcome people as ushers and greeters, and you have the gift of music. I'm sure Jane can always use more soloists, more instrumentalists, all those people. And there are people out there who have gifts, and you may think, well, she's already got a crew up there, but trust me, she'll put you to work.
I will.
You have gifts of planning and administration, you know? Do you have the gift of a wielding a hammer, you know, or swabbing a mop or a vacuum cleaner? Or are you a teacher? Many gifts are needed to make things grow and prosper. And each of you has something to offer in the service of the gospel, seeds that are needed to find the right ground. Maybe you've had gifts all along and you just didn't have the right place to plant those seeds so that they could take root and grow. Today, we claim new life as we sow new seeds for a vibrant future by planting Reverend A. Keith Mazingo in the good earth, in the holy ground of this place. And now it is time to sow new seeds that will blossom and will grow. What will you bring? What seeds will you sow to make this bright future a reality? Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. standing in God's presence on holy ground. What a challenge we have this morning to sow those seeds in faith that God can bring about a great harvest in our midst. And this morning, as we receive our tithes and offerings, we also remember the investment of our time, our talents, as well as our treasure, and that God multiplies it all. Thank God for His power, her power, to multiply and bring forth the harvest. God bless you as you give. Let's give in gratitude for what God is doing in our midst.
Just in finances, but as Dean said, with our time and our talents, and yes, God, as Wayne has called us, even with our testimonies, and we offer all that we are, all that we have, and all that we are yet to be to you today. Yes. We lift up those who cannot be with us this morning. We ask for healing. We ask for a touch of your spirit wherever they are. We ask for the blessings of the Holy Spirit to bless all that we do and say the rest of this time together. And we'll give you praise. It's for in your name we ask it, in the name of all that is holy. Amen.
Amen.
I'll tell you a very familiar story. It's a couple of thousand years old. You could probably tell it as well as I can tell it. But on a night that Jesus had gathered together with lots of folks and maybe some friends at the Passover feast that he hadn't seen since last year that time. And all of them gathered together. And let me just say this as an aside. I hope you can feel this like I feel this. There's something happens. And I hope all of MCC hears this. There's something spiritual, magical, whatever you want to call it. There's something special that happens when MCCers all get in the same room. from all over the place, from all over the world, that you can't find anywhere else.
All right.
And so if anybody comes to you and says anything other than we are still moving forward,
yes,
you just say, that ain't what the Holy Spirit said. There was probably some naysayers in that room with Jesus that night. I'm not going to preach. But there is an anointing in this place, and I think all the preachers can join me. Some of you that aren't even preachers could probably preach. But Jesus, knowing that his time was short with them, took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it. And he passed it to everyone in the room without condition. No conditions. None. He took the cup, he blessed it, and he passed that around to everyone in the room. He said, "This is the bread of life that is broken for all of you. And this is the cup of forgiveness, that every time you drink of it, all of those things that you've done that you shouldn't have done are forgiven. And all of those things that you didn't do that you should have done are forgiven. And now you have another opportunity to do that and make things right." I just want to say that has been our tradition since the very first service in Troy's living room, where there was a very mixed crowd. That in Metropolitan Community Church here in Los Angeles, at Founders, as well as MCCs all over the world, we serve in open communion. And that means you do not have to be a member of this church or any other church, of this faith or any other faith. I got in trouble for saying that one time here. But they forgave me. And hopefully they learned something from that parable. It doesn't matter what your heart condition, because you see, we believe in that holy moment that you take these simple elements, that something supernatural changes within us. It's that moment, that holy moment, that everything can change just like that for all of us, every single one of us. So you don't have to be a member of this church or any other church or this faith or any other faith to come and join us at the table, because you know it's not just Southern hospitality talking here. God says, "I've prepared a table before you, even in the presence of your enemies." So everyone is welcome at this table. We'll try our best to accommodate you. This is simple bread. We have the gluten-free bread too, if you need that. When you come forward, we'll take the bread, we'll dip it in the non-fermented grape juice, place it on your tongue, and we'll say an especially short blessing over you. There will be a station over here for those of you who do not necessarily want a blessing and do not want someone to serve you. You may take it and serve yourself. We just want to accommodate you as best we can. And as I said, everyone is welcome. The only thing we do ask is that you come as the ushers direct you. Would the acolytes and servers please come forward?
I've had many tears and sorrow. I've had questions for tomorrow. And at times I didn't know about the wrong. But at every single
Thank you.
may be seated.
But it's also prepared us. One of the beautiful gifts, we have so many talents in this church, and you know, I want to thank Norm Cox for setting the stage that reflects so much and such special things that mean that are appropriate for Reverend Keith in this day. What I also then want to begin this rite of installation with a very special video that we have received today. Sister Camille.
I'm Reverend Elder Rochelle Brown, here to say congratulations to Founders MCC. You have an amazing pastor being installed. Reverend Keith Mozingo comes with a heart filled with the Holy Spirit and a mind that is open enough to be present for the new beginnings that you all are experiencing. Yes. I have to say, I am excited about the sermon title. I can't wait to see it online myself, and I can't wait to be there October 6th for the 50th anniversary of MCC in the place where it all started, right there in Los Angeles. So while you celebrate today, know, Keith, you are in our prayers. Founders MCC, we are praying with you. We are behind you all. We are together in this work of sowing seeds for new beginnings. Blessings to you, Keith. May your heart remain open, filled with that fire, and may you receive exactly what you need in this moment, on this day. Many blessings to you all.
We thank the interim moderator for that message. I would like to invite Jenny Nichols, who represents the Pastoral Search Committee, to make a statement of how we got here and who is this person.
Good morning. Good morning. 8 months ago, the Spirit began speaking to the Pastoral Search Committee in a powerful way. We listened, we debated. We challenged each other, we prayed, we listened some more, and we prayed some more. And a bunch of other stuff in between. As you know, the result of that process was inviting Reverend Keith to candidate for the position of senior pastor. The traits that drew us to him were his love of God, his love of the Bible, a deep passion for equality, for fairness, for those who are underserved, as well as a smile on his soul. The weekend he candidated, we got to see a prophetic man of God who is not afraid to preach the true gospel. To challenge not only this congregation, but our entire denomination and make us think past the point of our own understanding, deep into the depths of our souls. Weekly, Pastor Keith preaches his interpretation of God's word. He causes us to search out our own truths as they relate to his words. He encourages us to live into those truths, to discover new truths, and to trust just a little bit deeper. His words have given us permission to laugh again, to find community again, and most of all, to hope again. Let us be grateful that this is the beginning of his journey with us, and gratefully look forward to the places his love and leadership will guide us. Today, I am honored and excited to invite Reverend Keith Mozingo to step forward for the rite of installation as senior pastor of Founders.
Too anxious. Will all the members present of the Pastoral Search Committee, will you stand? My apologies. I know that Camille is up at the booth. In the booth. There's a place for you a little later, but I want to acknowledge that Jesus has spoken for all of those, and also Kara Schipperberg, who is present with us in spirit. This has been a journey, and God is good. And so let me prepare the next stage of this. I just really want to thank Reverend Presley and Reverend Pat, Pastor Dale, because you're going to hear this again. But the good news is, as we again reflect on an installation in the covenant, it helps all of us put in context of what it means in this ritual, but this commitment to the next step to be the senior pastor of the church. And so I read this statement. Metropolitan Community Churches recognizes that God calls the whole church and every member to participate in and to extend the ministry of Jesus Christ by proclaiming the mighty acts of God who has called us to freedom. All members of the church are called as ministers of Christ in the church and in the world. Within MCC, the pastor is a duly ordained clergy person who has been licensed to practice. Though there are a variety of pastoral roles in a local congregation, the pastor is elected by the people of the church to be responsible for the duties of teacher, preacher, and spiritual leader. The primary task of the pastor is to encourage the ministry of the church's members by nurturing their faith, calling forth their gifts, and equipping them for service to the world. Yes. Today, we officially install Reverend Keith Mozingo as the senior pastor of Founders Metropolitan Community Church of Los Angeles, marking a new beginning in the life of this church. You see, an installation is a covenant between a pastor and a church. It is a ritual through which you agree that together you will do the work of God in this place. It is an occasion when both church and pastor agree that they will bring their gifts, commitment, time, and energy, and will offer them not for their individual interest, but to the life and health of this community and the wider communities in which you are called to engage. So, I have a charge to you, Reverend Keith. Will you come forward? Oh, those beautiful flowers. Good. Keith Mozingo, you have been called to live and serve in this community as a bearer of wisdom and truth, a minister of sacraments and rites, creator and nurturer of vision, and sustainer of love and order. My charge to you is that you hold this people in your heart, that you love them and keep them in prayer, that you empower and equip them to live out their ministries. Do not be distracted by insignificant things, for you have been called here to do things of great importance. Do not fear making mistakes. Ask for forgiveness when you need to, but never apologize for seeing great visions and dreaming great dreams. Francis of Assisi once said, "Preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary, use words." So lead by example. Speak your truth in love. Live, breathe, move, and talk in love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Show compassion to all, especially those who have no other defender. And in everything you do, act with justice, love with tenderness, and journey humbly with your God. And so at this time, I invite Dean Coffey up, the vice moderator of the board of directors, to offer these words and charge.
Reverend Keith Mozingo was called by the Congregation of Founders Metropolitan Community Church of Los Angeles to serve as our senior pastor at a duly called meeting of the congregation on April 8th, 2018. He was unanimously elected for this service. I think you still have a few votes out there. Reverend Keith, in the presence of this congregation, will you commit yourself to this new trust and responsibility and promise to discharge your duties in harmony with the spirit of this community of people?
With the help of God, I will.
Will you love, serve, and pray for these people of God, nourishing them with the teachings, the sacraments, and the wisdom of our God of many names to lead us forward to the best of your ability?
With the help of God, I will.
Will you lead this people in giving faithful witness and making known the love of God through loving service among themselves and in this community?
With the help of God, I will.
Amen. I invite all of the people of this community that we call Founders Metropolitan Community Church of Los Angeles to please rise in body or spirit. I ask, will you receive our new senior pastor, Reverend Keith, who continues the work of our community in moving us forward as reflected in our mission statement? We challenge each other to make our lives count as we invite everyone to be transformed in mind, body, and spirit from a place of trust, wholeness, and holiness. We reach out as the hands, feet, and heart of Christ through acts of justice and compassion to make a difference in our world. Will you regard him as a fellow minister and work with him in the ministry of this congregation? If so, please say, we will.
We will.
Will you pray for him and honor him for his work's sake, and in all things strive together in the peace and unity of our community and also the community of the greater church?
We will.
Please be seated.
Well, we have a special moment here. Reverend Keith has talked a lot about connections and community. And so this next element of our ceremony, this rainbow connection, Reverend Keith is clear that we cannot be by ourselves, that we need to extend and to continue to invite and be included in communities. And if we work collectively, we will make not only our local community a better place, but the world. And so he wants to offer a piece of ribbon, which is reflected of the six colors in the gay rainbow flag, to begin a commitment to various groups. And don't misunderstand the group name. It's just a way of just describing entities and elements. Of again making his own commitment to serve and work on behalf of the greater community, but also invite others to work with and serve with him in that effort endeavored. And so what I would like to first do is invite group number one, and there is no order to this other than just to get people up. And so I want to invite the transition team that was in place until they arrive, that being Dean is present, Antonio, Tony, Martinez is present, Roger, Pamela Fairbanks, and Onetta and Patrice in. Beginning, would you come forward and stand on number one sign, and as
this ribbon, I'm committing myself to work with you, not just on what was past, but on future endeavors to make this the best community and the best church that we can be. And in taking this ribbon, will you commit that back to me?
We also invite members of the Pastoral Search Committee. Now, we realize there are members who will be a part of several, and so I want to invite Roger, as well as Jeff, Jenny, Camille, Art, Bruce, and Carol in spirit to come forward. Offer the orange.
And I make a commitment to work with you on future endeavors, and maybe looking for other people to join us, not take my place, join us. As God calls them as well. Will you make that commitment to work with me as well?
We'd like to invite the board of directors of Founders MCC. That is Dean, is, I know, how many? Dean, Roger. Tony, Art, Oi, Bob.
I extend this yellow ribbon to work with you, the board of directors, who have been so gracious to me already and looking after me and making sure that everything is, I'm getting settled in, and that we are working and staying on track as a church on the business side. And I commit myself to work with you on these endeavors in the future, and I ask for your commitment to work with me.
We will.
I'd like to invite the next group, where many of our churches belong, the MCC Western U.S. Network. I invite the leader, Jude Spurk, who's present, and really anyone or any churches or leaders who are present here today, Resurrection Beach, I know there's the MCC UC, the Valley, Las Vegas, any of those, are just as long as there's a representative, you can all come, but wanna again invite you to the connection, the Rainbow Connection, over there with Jude. Don't worry about the space, it all looks good.
I extend this green ribbon to you, my Western MCC network and commit myself to work with you to build our network and bless our network as, and do the work that we need to do to supply resources to others and to benefit from your resources as well. And I ask for your commitment to do the same.
Well, we're not all by ourselves. We would like to invite many of our interfaith leaders, like Reverend Jonathan, the Unitarian Universalist Association. I know that Reverend Pat, there's the LQL, there's Very Human, and other representatives. If you are a part of our other interfaith, and I know we like to watch people, you join the circle connection.
As part of our interfaith group and as part of community groups outside of our local church, I make a commitment to work with you to build our community, not just a community of faith, but our community, our real community in this city, in this state, to make a difference where there may not be a difference otherwise. And I extend this ribbon to you. Will you commit to work with me as well?
And this last but not the least that expands, and we do watch as he gets tangled, it's always a joyful experience. This is not only our volunteer clergy here and other clergy who are present, I'd like to also include all staff members of Founders MCC and any volunteers who really come in weekly to make things happen. Just come and join part of six, don't be shy. Just stand in front, it's all good. We're not trying to just. We could call out people's names. Karina, I like that. I used to get called a lot.
And so you, whether you are paid staff or volunteer staff, I make a commitment to work with you to do the best that we can do for this congregation, to bless these people week after week after week and all during the week. And I will ask if you will commit to work with me to do the same.
We invite you, if you're able, to stand as we hear the voice of Tone. And all of you stand as we hear the voice of Tony Arianis. And I'll get your name right before you leave.
Yeah. Lord, every day of my life, Lord, I live it with you.
We thank you. We thank you for your yes. We are about to have Reverend Alex Scott come and lay hands and say prayer. We invite you to stay up here, or if you feel comfortable, go back to your seat if you need to seat. I'd like to invite Reverend Troy Perry up to come near as we begin this part of the process. Just drop it.
If anyone else wants to come up and lay hands, you're more than welcome. And Reverend Troy, I want you to be in a position where you're comfortable. All right. The Spirit is already here. I don't have to invoke her. But I do know that oftentimes it doesn't hurt to invite and re-invite. So I'm just going to read a little something. Don't worry, my prayer ain't scripted. I have anointing oil, and this oil comes from the first church that he pastored. This is the Rock MCC, Chattanooga, Tennessee. Now, the stole that Reverend Keith is wearing is from his late friend, Daryl Mitchell. They started ordination program together, and sadly, Daryl was killed in July of 2000. He was ordained posthumously. Now, Carol is Daryl's twin, and she gave Keith this stole. As we lay hands on you, and as the Spirit crosses boundaries, and as I'm having trouble opening this anointing oil, but a seed was sown. And so I anoint you. May God continue to open your mind. I anoint you. May God continue to open your lips. I anoint you that God may continue to open your hands. And I anoint you that God continue to open your hearts. And loving God, you have asked us to journey through a desert. And we often ask, why? And now you continue to ask us, trust, for I am creating something new. And out of the wilderness came a man that said, I want to be your next senior pastor. Right. And we opened our arms, we opened our hearts, we opened our doors, and we opened this house that you have created and that you have built, and you allowed this man to come forward. And I pray, loving God, that you anoint him with the strength that he needs. I invite you to continue to open his lips that he may speak as you would speak. Yes. To open his eyes that he may see as you may see. Yes. To open his ears that he may hear as you would. Yes. And allow his life to be the living presence that you embody in his body and in our body. Loving God, I invite the presence of the Holy Spirit to fall afresh on Reverend Keith right now, and allow the presence of that fire to ignite in him, and allow that presence of that fire to touch each and every one of us, and allow that fire to burn away every fear, every doubt, every sense of unknowing, because you are working a miracle right now. And I ask you, loving God, as you continue to guide his feet, as you continue to lift him up and fill his heart, may we be living testimonies of what it is that you continue to do, that these doors, these walls, this very foundation may continue to tremble with your hope, with your love, and with joy. And in doing so, the light that you have given him may shine out to the world and come back renewed. In Christ's holy name we pray, and the people say,
Amen.
Thank you. Yes. You may have a seat.
We know by MCC Las Vegas being present, the Reverend Robert Fleming sends his. We understand by Reverend Clinton Crenshaw's church, the MCC of the Coachella Valley, they acknowledge their presence. We acknowledge Reverend Dan Koschel with the presence of MCC San Diego. We also have acknowledgments from the Reverend Allison Rowland, from pastor of MCC New Orleans, sends her best wishes. We know that by Reverend Dr. Pat Ling Lewis, MCC UC in the Valley, their presence acknowledges your presence. Well, the former pastor, the Reverend Carlton, Lee Carlton, sends blessings to you on this day in our congregation. We acknowledge that Reverend Jennifer Kwan from the Unitarian Universalist Association, his presence acknowledges you. We also have letters of acknowledgement from the Congregation Koami in West Hollywood from the Rabbi Denise Edgar. So many people love and wanted to acknowledge. And I won't open this, but the county supervisor of district number two, Mark Ridley Thomas, has sent a commendation. We'll open it so everyone can read it. It's a wonderful experience. It's pretty, too. So, you know, the city knows about you. Let me just acknowledge this in pretty little letters over the colors. And what I understand, we didn't even ask for it. They just knew. So that says a lot about us founders in CC. But I also want to bring forth, yes, amen, Jenny Nichols, you have a presentation on behalf of this congregation.
Reverend Keith, on behalf of the Pastoral Search Committee, the Board of Directors, and all of us at Founders Metropolitan Community Church, we welcome you finally, and we present you with this present, this gift.
I said one Sunday, I am the rainbow sheep of my family.
I'm sure there are other gifts, and I invite you during the reception or just afterwards. So again, that's an opportunity to share. We're just so grateful for your presence being one of the best gifts that you could give. And so in my final statement before I call up Dean, well, I'm going to say this to them. Will you welcome the newly installed senior pastor of Metropolitan Community Churches, Pastor Keith Mozingo, fully installed and famous.
So I've been tasked with decommissioning the Pastoral Search Committee. Who has worked diligently over the last couple of years, last 3 years. They thought their duties were over last year, and we had a storm. And they brought the ship through the storm, and through, every person on that committee volunteered to do another tour of duty and brought us to this place of Reverend Keith's installation. And so would you join me in expressing your thanks to the Pastoral Search Committee for their years of work. Amen. And then the transition team, we want to, as a congregation, express our thanks to their leadership during this time of transition. Reverend Kevin Downer appointed us as the transition team. And I wish I could say, transition team, we're going to decommission you too, but we can't. We still have more transition to do till we get Reverend Keith just totally in place and motivating the rest of us after the sermon this morning, motivating the rest of us to do the work that God has called us to do. Let's express our thanks to the transition team.
While he's coming up, we're going to have a closing song.
Yes, we are.
And then closing remarks. And
all right. Come on, let's welcome back Tony Arias. And
please rise as you're able.
Thank you. Wow. Wow for the whole day. Now, while there's some other things, some movement going on, I told Tony he needs to go on downstairs and get something to eat because he's going to be entertaining us while we eat. So we get some more.
Please stay with us. He's doing a whole Vegas set. Get ready.
So I asked them to go on down and get something to eat while we're doing this. And I'm also asking Jane and Alex if they will come up and join me here. Actually, let's come right down here.
Come here.
I asked them to come and stand with me, and I can say a whole lot of things, and I promise I'm not. So I want to say thank you for people coming far and near. And thank you for these musicians that have come in. Thank you for our local musicians, my voces. Muchas gracias. Muchas gracias. They sang that song recently. I said, what is that song? What is that song? I want that song. I need that song. And they were so anointed and so blessed. And I've been praying for the anointing. And I must tell you that this week has been so hard for me. And it wasn't until Monday. I mean, there have been people that got left out and saying, why are you not calling me back? And it's because they kept saying, this is your service. It's all about you. It's all about you. And I just could not do it. I was not procrastinating. I just couldn't do it. Finally, Jane got on the phone Monday on a holiday and called me and said, we have to do this now. And then on Tuesday, Onetta got on the phone with me and said, I'm taking charge because you're not doing this. And I said, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And I will repeat what Reverend Barbara said to me a while ago. Reverend Barbara Haynes whispered to me after the prayer that Alex prayed over me. And she said, well, we put God on the spot now. God can't change God's mind. It's kind of a done deal. Signed, sealed, delivered. I'm yours. And I saw you singing that too. And I was listening and thinking that you're mine. And so I want to say thank you for the teams that work so diligently, that we want to recognize those people. And I want to say out there for those people that are looking, if you applied and didn't get it, it's because it wasn't God's will. And I don't say that lightly. It wasn't God's will. Because I know. But it also means that you're willing to say yes to whatever God's will is. So you hang in there if you haven't heard yet, because God's got it for you too. And for those people who they approached and said, would you come and apply? And you said, no, I want to say thank you. Reverend Troy, they didn't tell me how many they asked, but I know there's some out there. Because after I was elected, several preachers called me and said, well, you know, they asked me, but I said no. I said, thank you, because I said this before and I will say it again. The last thing that I said to the pastoral search team on the last interview was the one advantage that I have over all of the other candidates is that I already love you to pieces. Yes. I don't have to learn to love you. I already love you to pieces. Yes. I do. I absolutely adore you. And I know that you love me because I feel it. I do, I feel it, and I say thank you. And what a wonderful day, and what a wonderful tribute, and thank you, Wayne, for coming. Yeah. Yeah. Sowing some more good seeds, sowing some really fertile soil. So would you rise as you're able? I asked Jane and Alex to join me in this prayer because I want you to see it's not just me. This is our team. This is us. All working together. And all those ribbons, God showed me a little flash of what that was supposed to look like and all the people that are supposed to come because, and did you notice that people had to keep moving around from group to group? It wasn't just Roger, believe it or not. We're going to have to get him off of a few things, obviously. When you say no, it gives somebody else the ministry to say yes. No, we appreciate Roger. We appreciate all of you that are volunteering, but did you notice the interconnectedness and the people having to move from group to group? But it also means that there are places vacant. And we can step up. We can step up to make things happen. Reverend Don, you came in and visited with us a couple of weeks ago, former pastor of this church. May I tell what you told me? The word of prophecy, is it okay, or is it yours to share? And I don't mind if you share it instead.
I know with all my heart that you are supposed to be the pastor of this church. I knew it when they told me. I knew it when I saw you. I knew it when I hugged you and could feel the Spirit of God moving through you. It is an incredible gift to be a pastor of this church, and the things that are ahead for you will bring you incredible joy as you bless God's people and help them move forward. So with all my heart, I say, I love you. I am so glad you heard God's call and said yes. Because it is the will of God. Amen.
And when Spirit speaks, we listen around here. Amen. Would you pray with me? God, thank you for this time and this fellowship, and thank you for this, even though it's a rite of installation, a rite of blessing in this place, that most of all, what we want to see in this place, not just today, but every single day, is the Holy Spirit leading every single thing that we do, every decision we make, pushing us when it's uncomfortable, and helping us to have more faith than we've ever had before. That the revival spirit that Reverend Lee Carlton pronounced over this place continues. That new people continue to come in and former people continue to be blessed. And those of us that have been around for a long time, we continue to re-sow on more fertile soil. God, I ask, Lord, today that your Spirit guide everything. Help us to hear your voice. Help us not to be afraid. We've taken a lot of commitments today. Help us to hold true to all of them. Help us to love one another more than we ever have before. And as I heard over and over in this place, I'll come in here sometimes by myself, God, and I keep hearing your Spirit say, there's enough forgiveness in this place for everyone. There's enough forgiveness in this place. I hear it over and over. There's enough forgiveness in this place. Enough forgiveness in this place for all of us. So forgive us when we need forgiveness. And help us to move forward. Help us not to stay stuck in the past, but to move forward for what you've called for us to do in the future. Let this church be a light shining out in this community and beyond. And let them see the fire of the Holy Spirit burning in this place. And know that they feel something. They're drawn to this place. Because they want what we have. We ask now that you will bless our food and our fun and our fellowship this afternoon together. To the nourishments of our bodies to your service and your divine will. And God, one more time, thank you for calling us together in this day, in this time, in this moment. In Jesus' name.